Hello, I'm Ronnie Eldridge. Welcome to Eldridge & Company. One of the most stunning advances in medical science is the ability to give life to people who 20 years ago had no hope. Thankfully, just recently, my friend Virginia was one of those people. I'm pleased that my guest, Elaine Berg, the president of the New York Organ Donor Network, can explain this wondrous feat. And welcome.
Thanks, Ronnie,
for having me. So let's talk about organ donation. What was the first time that ever happened?
Well, the first kidney transplant was actually done in 1954, and it was a living donation, actually, between two twins, brothers. And, you know, the issue of immunosuppression and compatibility didn't exist at that time, so it was a perfect match, and actually they both did well for quite a long time afterwards. But transplantation didn't really take off big time until really the mid-80s, when cyclosporine and these other immunosuppressions were created and enabled strangers to donate to each other.
So that was the important point that changed the whole thing.
The immunosuppression.
How many people have, do you know, how many people have gotten organ transplants?
A few hundred thousand over the years.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
So what's the network?
The New York Organ Donor Network is part of a national system. We cover downstate New York, and we do everything that has anything to do with donation. We do public education, like being on this wonderful show, and we do all of the clinical and medical work involved in evaluating a potential donor, doing the allocation.
There are two lists, then. I mean, you have to find a donor. But then there's a central register, a list of people who need the donation.
Right. And a lot of people confuse those two things.
So you have nothing really to do with the list.
We have the waiting list is sacrosanct. That is really overseen by a contractor to the federal government. It's a national waiting list. The only thing that we have to do with that list is when we get a donor, we submit the donor information to that list, and on a computer, a match happens, and then we are told,
right,
this is the next person.
So there's no favoritism. Wasn't it rumored with Mickey Mantle? What was that? I don't know. You know, I don't
understand. God bless him. Yes. and it's amazing how people always
remember
Mickey Mantle.
Yeah, right.
in fact, I think there's only one way possibly to manipulate the system.
Yeah.
And honestly, it is not done. But the one way that it could be done is if your doctor either omits some medical information or plays around with some medical information. I think we all know there are no transplant surgeons at this point that are willing to do that. But Mantle was, in fact, on top of the list.
Oh,
he was so ill that he was going to die if he didn't get a liver transplant.
So, the concept of giving an organ, has that been a difficult concept to sell to people?
It is. It is difficult.
Yeah.
And I think that's one of the reasons that not enough people donate.
Yeah. It's so amazing to me because, I mean, having someone dear and close to you to die, it's such a finality and such a waste of that person's life that my instinct is to say anything that I can do to make that death worth something.
Yeah.
And how do we get that message out to people?
Well, you know, I think on some level people know that message, but there are very highly emotional issues that come into play when we're dealing with death. First of all, none of us want to confront our own mortality, so signing a donor card is, you know, very difficult. It's as difficult as writing a will and all the other things, advanced directives that people should do that don't. And I think that's one issue. But at that moment when a family is in the hospital looking at their loved one, confronting their loved one's death, and we talk to them about donation, superstitions come about. I mean, you know, people say, yeah, I'll give everything but the eyes, or I'll only give the heart because or I can't see my loved one cut up. Or, you know, I mean, there's all kinds of very emotional issues.
So your staff, the people who talk to the family, is your staff. That's a very sensitive job.
It's an amazing job.
Yeah. And what kind of training do you have?
Well, we have a very wide variety of
people
that do that.
Jobs?
They're all full-time. They're all full-time, and all they do is this. We used to have nurses do this, but we really found that separating the clinical and this sort of family counseling piece worked better. And, you know, I'll tell you what they think. And if you don't think this way, you can't do this job. Right. The person's dead. Can we make something positive out of
this?
And they
thing.
Walk in really believing that. Yeah. And I think they transmit that belief.
And there are people like them at every hospital?
We have a couple that are attached to hospitals, to, you know, some of the larger hospitals. But then we have a whole staff that respond when there's a...
So when there's a death, you're somehow notified?
Yes.
Day and night?
Day and night.
Isn't that amazing?
It's actually both a federal and a state law now that hospitals are required to call us on every death. And I think this is important, too, because we're called whether there's a donor card or if someone's on the registry or if they're 105 years old and died of cancer. It doesn't matter. We are called, and we begin the screening process. And if someone is physically capable of donating, we will show up at the hospital whether or not they've registered to be a donor.
Right.
And
that's
we'll talk to the family.
Registry. That's the next question I was going to ask you. Mm-hmm. You don't have to have pre-registered.
Not to have that discussion with us.
But it is wise to tell your family that that's what you want.
Well, you know, what we have found is that if your family knows your wishes, it really helps them through the process. Yeah. I mean, it's sort of the last thing that they can really do for you.
Yeah.
And we've really found, I mean, every survey that's been done shows that people who have donated, families who have helped their loved ones donate, just have felt very good about it.
And it's not enough to put it in your will, because that doesn't really get read till much later.
We don't see the
will.
That's
too late. You have a connection, though, with the federal government.
Yes.
What is that?
Well, we are actually designated, our territory, if you will, is designated by the federal government. And we have to follow regulations, of course, and we have to make certain metrics. You know, we have to make
And where do you get the money to pay the staff?
Basically, what happens is we have this very complicated formula that figures out how much it costs us to recover a heart or a lung or a liver or a kidney, and when we provide one of those to a transplant center, they pay us that amount of money. So we're a nonprofit, you know, we're not allowed to make money on this, but we recover our costs.
And where does the transplant center get their money?
Basically from third parties. Yeah, either Medicare or, you know, an HMO. You know, when the patient comes in to get that transplant, whatever insurance they have covers the transplant.
So there is no cost at all to the donor family?
No cost
at all.
As a matter of fact, when we take a donor to the operating room, we will pay that hospital for the time
procedure that
it takes to do the donation, because it's a pretty complicated
and
procedure.
And does the people who do that operation, who you know, remove the organs, are they connected to the hospital? Or
they are the transplant surgeons, actually.
At the hospital, they are the surgeons.
So if we have a donor who's giving a heart and a kidneys and a lung, you know, we could have a surgeon from NYU and Mount Sinai and Columbia coming in to recover that organ.
Even though they may not get it.
No, they're actually taking the one that they're going to give to their patient.
I see.
The allocation's done already before we take the donor to the operating room.
And so if it's in Philadelphia, say, they have to come here.
They do.
That's when you
see them running.
They're
dramatic.
Exactly. They run to the airplane with a cup.
And it's true, because the time limit between the time that an organ is recovered, like a heart, for example, between removing it from the body and transplanting it, we only have about 5 hours. So they really have to run. And that's one of the reasons that we will not, for example, allocate a heart from New York to a patient in California, because it won't get there.
Then it's useless. Yeah. Now, so the organs that you transplant are?
There are eight.
Heart, lung.
Heart, two lungs.
Two lungs. I see. They count as two.
Yes.
The pancreas.
Pancreas.
The liver.
Liver.
Two kidneys.
And what we miss. Oh, intestines.
Intestines.
Yeah. There are people that actually are critically ill with all kinds of nutritional disorders and inability to digest food.
Right. And there is really, I mean, people after this, the body is not disfigured.
No.
So that people who have funeral services with an open casket, you can't tell at
no
all
problem.
That the eye, that they have been done.
Absolutely.
So
no
we've
problem.
Talked about organs, but they're also tissues. And it interests me that eyes are tissues.
Yeah. And it's kind of
what's the distinction?
It's I think an artificial distinction. Really, it has more to do with how much time we have to recover tissues rather than organs. So organs, you know, we generally have a very short time frame. Mm-hmm. Tissues, the patient can be cardiac dead in the mortuary for up to 24 hours. And we have that time to actually bring and recover the tissues. And the whole allocation system for tissues is very different. There's not a waiting list for tissues. It's kind of done more, you know, through hospital operating rooms and so on.
Networks that you've established?
Yeah.
So a tissue is a whole eye?
It would
a
mostly
cornea?
Be cornea. That, you know, we don't transplant whole eyes.
No.
It's really more corneas.
All right.
We transplant skin, very thin layers of skin on burn patients mm-hmm. to, you know, help them recover from burns. Bone mm-hmm. for all kinds of spinal surgeries and cancer.
And
you
there have been sometime. All these recent scandals about
oh, yeah.
people sell, right?
Yeah. Well,
that doesn't help you, or does it?
It doesn't help us.
Yeah.
It doesn't help us. And you know, there are proposed regulations yeah. to try and make sure right. that doesn't happen anymore. The organs are so regulated by the federal right. government that tissues are not as regulated.
Do you think the tissues will be?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I think so.
Especially after the black market and all
and
this
they
kind
should
of
be.
Stuff.
Yeah. There's really no, I mean, you know, if you give a gift as a donor, why right. would, you yeah. know, a cornea be any different than
right.
a heart?
And
be.
You also include in the tissues muscle, I mean, ligaments?
There are, yeah, there are certain ligaments, you know, with all the sports mm-hmm. injury that's mm-hmm. going on now, we can actually transplant ACLs and tendons and.
So tissues are not usually life-saving? Except
they're,
the burn
right,
patients, I
right,
guess they would be.
Right.
But they're not. They're more.
We call them life
injury,
enhancing.
Enhancing.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, how many people are now waiting for donations of an organ?
Well, nationally, there are about 100,000 people on the list. And, you know, the painful part about this, you know, it's not. End-stage organ disease yeah. is not the volume that cancer yeah. is or
right.
anything like that.
Right.
The numbers are not there. But. The cure is there,
yeah.
and it's us.
Yeah,
you know, it's that's all it is. The limiting factor for saving these lives is just people, you know, understanding what this is about and being willing to.
I have a terrible story about my late brother who had polio when he was young, and it came back. It was, I mean, you didn't know he had polio years later, but he had that syndrome later on, and all this trouble and the medication that he gave affected his kidneys, and he needed a kidney transplant. He was on dialysis. He was heavy, and he had to lose a lot of weight before he became eligible, but he became eligible. And then suddenly one night he had an intestinal obstruction, so he needed emergency surgery, and he didn't come out of it. His wife, after the funeral, got home. There was a message on the machine that they had the kidney for
oh,
him.
Oh, God.
It was so sad,
oh,
you
God.
Know. But you see, I mean, firsthand what people go through waiting for that organ. My friend Virginia, who had the liver transplant recently, she had hepatitis C.
Mm-hmm.
And she's a young woman in the film business and terrific. And people were watching her getting sicker and sicker. And then it happened and she's
miraculous.
Cured.
I mean, that's the
yeah,
other thing.
Yeah.
I think another misconception is, oh, I'm going to donate my organ to this person. They're going to be an invalid.
Right.
I mean, you cannot tell people who have had transplants. They
it's
go
so
back
amazing.
To work.
Yeah.
They're functioning members of society, and they would be dead.
So it's all using the organs plus the immune suppressant,
mm-hmm.
and
yeah.
that continues to advance,
yeah.
right?
I mean, they have to take immunosuppression
yeah.
forever. There's no
yeah.
question about that. But, you know, hopefully that'll improve
right.
as well.
Are there single groups that you find need organs more? Does it divide down racially? Are there religiously, there are groups that are not in favor of organ removal, or very few, or is that individual too? You can't say it's a whole religious sect. It's
well, I'll tell you a great story.
Okay.
We have people, and it's a frequent thing,
yeah.
you know, families will tell us it's against my religion. Well, what religion are you? I'm Catholic. Well, you know, here we have documentation that the Pope is a card-carrying organ donor. He supports it. I don't care what the Pope says. I swear this is a true story. It happens all the time. So, you know, I think in the end, you know, we all become very religious all of a sudden, whether or not we were in our lives. But, you know, you want to do everything right. And whatever your belief system is, you know, it kind of, it's a little bit irrational.
Do the chaplains at the hospital help?
Very much. We rely very much on the chaplains in the hospital. Right. And, you know, a lot of our grassroots education takes place in churches, in the African American community, where, you know, we're in there all the time, you know, in synagogues, in mosques, in, you know, anywhere we can go, because we do feel that that's a really good way to
approach
people.
Does sickle cell anemia affect an organ?
Yeah, it can. Yeah,
that's interesting.
It can.
Yeah.
There are, you know, there are a disproportionate number of African Americans on the waiting list because there's a disproportionate number of them who have hypertension, and, you know, that affects your kidneys, diabetes affects your kidneys. So we work in that community because what we're trying to say is get more people to donate so that we can meet that.
But you don't have to have an African American kidney to put it into an African American person.
It's an amazing thing that we really are all the same inside.
Isn't that incredible under that color?
It's an amazing thing.
Beautiful color skin. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's pretty
amazing.
That,
what about age? Can I give my organs even though I'm...
Well, at 21, yes, you
can. Right. And at 77, what do you do?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You can't give all your organs. You know, as we get older, we kind of use some of them up. But livers, for example, are notoriously transplantable. And we've transplanted livers from people over 90, 92, 93, and they work really well.
It's
I always
amazing.
Say that the recipient just has this irrepressible urge for early bird specials, but other than that, they do really well.
But sometimes if it's a heart, it has to be related to the size of the cavity that you're going to put it in.
Yes.
So a baby, you can't give a heart, and I couldn't give the right.
No. It's size, it's weight, it's blood type. You know, there's a list of criteria, basic criteria, that that have to match up.
Do people know who the recipient is?
They can later on. This is sort of, I have a close friend who's a, she's an adoption attorney. And
it's like that, yeah.
Over and over we go, oh my God, you know, this is the same thing. It's like the old days of adoption. We really keep the recipient donor separate. We're sort of the conduit. They can write to each other, and at a point that they want to disclose their identity to each other, we arrange for that to happen. And we've actually had meetings between donors and recipients. I mean, every time I think about it, I get chills. It's just one of the most extraordinary experiences. And it really, we try to get as many of our staff there as we can because it's like that's what it's all about, really.
Yeah. There hasn't been a brain transplant.
Not yet.
There will be someday.
Probably.
I'm sure. Absolutely.
I look forward to that day, actually. Not yet.
Yeah. The recipients, your recipients tell wonderful story. I mean, your donors tell wonderful stories about the feelings they get from having, really continued the whole legacy of their personally lost.
You know, studies that have been done, you know, broadly, definitely show that the act of donation helps a family through the grief of losing somebody. But anecdotally, I mean, I only have 150 employees. We have about 450 volunteers, and virtually all of them are either recipients, which you can understand, or donor families. They really get so involved in the process, and it really does. It helps. It helps because it makes sense out of a loss, you know, particularly with younger people.
Totally.
I mean, and people really feel that their loved one is living on.
It's really quite amazing. So how does somebody, what do you put on your driver's license?
Okay, let's debunk the myth of a driver's license right now.
Okay.
If you've ever seen the back of your driver's license and written on it, you will know that in 2 seconds it gets erased.
Off. Right.
So it's pointless.
Right.
So in 2001, New York State, and this is happening in many states across the country, we established this registry. So it's a computerized registry. You can sign on online. 98% of people on the registry now, all you have to do is check a box when you renew your license. So just check a box and your name gets sent to the Department of Health.
Yeah. Oh, that's very good.
And so whenever someone dies, one of the first things we do, even before we talk to the family, is we'll check and see if that person's on the registry. And we will go to the family with that information.
Are families sometimes surprised?
They're surprised, but they're sometimes surprised. And that's another reason that we keep saying, tell your family.
Right.
You know, you signed up on the registry. Right. Why? You don't keep it a secret. Tell your family.
And you can do that. Then you can go online?
You can do it online, through the State Department of Health or through our website, which I think we'll be showing folks later.
Right. And then can you, do you distribute these?
Or you can write it in.
And are these distributed in places like where?
Every time we do, any kind of education or anything, we bring these along. They're in five languages.
I guess doctors don't want to put it in their office.
Some of them do. We try to get them to, actually.
They should, definitely.
And they do. We have them all over the place.
And the libraries and things like that? I don't know, but that what you could
ask. Libraries are a good idea.
Yeah.
I don't think we've done that.
Oh,
that's
good.
A great idea.
All right, very good.
Yeah.
I mean, of all those central places where people go, because it's such a great thing. So, and there is total accountability. And, I mean, you're not just off there alone taking this. This is part of a very large official network.
Yeah.
So how did you start doing all this?
Oh, it was an accident. It was a nice accident.
Yes, it was.
I've been in healthcare for 30 years. Now 38 years. I was a hospital administrator. And one day I got a call from a search firm.
Yeah.
And I said, that sounds like a really amazing job. And it has been.
Yeah.
It's been 8 years, feels like 2 weeks.
It's so great. It's a very gratifying thing.
It really is. It's
hard. Have I missed anything that we should talk about this?
I don't think so. I mean, I think the important thing is the registry, that people understand that signing the back of your driver's license is not the best way to do it, that this is really the best way to do it.
But if you check your renewal form, that's also a good way because you're then right on it.
And we actually just changed the law, so when you get your license back, it'll actually say organ donor in the front.
Oh, that's great. That's terrific. I have to look at mine and see what happens.
It just changed. And, unfortunately, now we renew our driver's licenses every 10 years, so it's going to take a long time until people begin to see
that. Is the whole country covered by networks?
Yes, there's 58 of us throughout the country.
And you're the second largest, is that what I read?
We're the second largest.
What's the largest, California?
Southern California.
That's very good. And the website number is?
It's www.donateLifeNY.org.
And all doctors are totally...
Supportive
and eager to help?
I think most are. You know, there are some who, like everybody,
old-fashioned.
Have their own, concerns and superstitions about it.
Since you don't need the immediate transfer, do funeral parlors ever make suggestions about tissues?
We work very closely with funeral directors.
Yeah.
Very closely because, I mean, I don't know if you've ever had a death.
But unfortunately, they
really want to get the body into the funeral home as quickly as possible.
Right.
So we really notify them. There's a donor, and we work with them on scheduling and so on.
And then I've read that the number of cremations has increased. So that should really be...
It's irrelevant.
It's irrelevant. Yeah. But it should help.
It should.
If people are afraid of having their loved one cut, it's the same as autopsies, right? Do you find the same resistance?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really an emotional... I mean, I don't want to say to people, think about the alternative that, your body is going to decompose. I mean, that's not pretty. There's nothing about death that's pretty, So surgery is not a pretty thing, but,
All right, but giving life to somebody who really needs it is a very wonderful, beautiful thing.
It's a very beautiful thing.
And I hope that everybody will go to your website, which is... Again, let's repeat it.
www.donatelifeny.org.
Right. And hopefully we will see a future where you won't have to have a waiting list.
Let's hope so.
It would be wonderful.
Thank you. Ronnie, thank you so much.
Thank you,
Elaine. It was really
a pleasure. It was great. Thank you very much. If there are any people you'd like to hear and topics you'd like us to explore, please let me know. You can write to me at CUNY TV, 365 Fifth Avenue, New York, New York, 10016, or you can go to the website at cuny.tv and click on Contact Us. I look forward to hearing from you.